Summer of 1996 saw the release of two big-budget disaster movies, Independence Day and Twister. Critics weren't too big on either film, but that didn't matter in the slightest, because they ended up being the two highest-grossing films of that year, which, of course, got Hollywood executives asking the most important question of all. What else can we blow up? The success of these two films kicked off a frenzy of disaster movies for the next few years, with studios scrambling so desperately to replicate that success that we ended up getting twin disaster movies 2 years in a row. Dante's Peak and Volcano in 1997, followed by Armageddon and Deep Impact in 1998. I already did a video about those two, link in the description, so today we're going to be talking about the two Volcano movies. Dante's Peak hit first and is about Harry Dalton, a volcanologist working for the United States Geological Survey, who's called in from his vacation to go and check out a volcano in Washington following some seismic activity. There he meets and befriends Rachel Wando, the mayor of the small town at the base of the mountain, and after becoming convinced that the volcano is going to erupt, tries to put the town on alert despite pushback from his boss. Volcano came out 2 months later and is much, much dumber. A minor earthquake occurs in Los Angeles, and shortly thereafter, seven public works employees burn to death in an underground tunnel, and the head of the Office of Emergency Management, Mike Rourke, is called in from his vacation to investigate. He consults a scientist who theorizes that a volcano is forming underneath the city, and no one believes her until suddenly it erupts. Side note, what's with both protagonists being called in from vacation to deal with a volcano? That's an oddly specific thing for two movies about volcanoes to have in common.
Not even supposed to be here today.
Both movies did okay financially. Neither hit the heights of Twister or Independence Day from the previous year, but they didn't exactly flop either. Critics, however, weren't especially jazzed about either of them, with Dante's Peak currently sitting at 26% on Rotten Tomatoes and Volcano coming in at 50%, which is fucking baffling to me because Dante's Peak is better by a huge fucking margin. It really just goes to show that movie critics have no idea what they're talking about. Any of them. Ever. Even me. Especially me. For starters, Dante's Peak is based more on reality than the absolute bonkers Volcano. And I know I seem to flip-flop when it comes to this. I prefer Deep Impact over Armageddon because Deep Impact was more realistic, but then turned around and said I prefer Judge Dredd 95 over Dredd 2012 and Godzilla 98 over Godzilla 2014 because they were silly and less gritty and realistic. And then turned around again and favored Mission to Mars over Red Planet because Mission to Mars was more realistic. So I totally get why I might seem like I contradict myself in this regard. So here's the thing. If a movie has a premise that is already based on something that could happen, like a natural disaster or going to Mars in the near future, I prefer the movie itself to be more grounded in reality. But if the movie is based on something not realistic, like a hyper-stylized comic book set hundreds of years in the future or a giant monster, then I want it to be silly and outlandish. Volcanoes are real, so hit me with that realistic science, baby. Dante's Peak certainly takes some creative liberties with the science, because, you know, it's a movie. But, like, come on, Volcano doesn't even take place in a location where something like that could physically happen, and it just gets dumber from there. Los Angeles is very near to the San Andreas Fault, hence the earthquakes. See, earthquakes are caused by tectonic plates shifting past one another, which is what happens in the San Andreas Fault. Volcanoes, on the other hand, occur in areas where two tectonic plates collide and one is pushed underneath the other, creating a subduction zone, which forces magma to the surface. This doesn't happen at the San Andreas Fault, which means there's no source of magma and therefore no volcano. So right from the get-go, the movie's main conceit is completely absurd. Dante's Peak certainly has moments that are dumb, like the scene where a truck drives over lava and not only does not immediately explode, but continues to function perfectly afterwards, but Volcano is literally built around a stupid idea. Most of the events in Dante's Peak actually happen in real life. Volcanoes can kill trees and wildlife before they erupt. They can turn lakes into acid. They can explode in a massive cloud that destroys everything in its path. These things happen in the real world, which makes it more frightening when they happen in the movie. Volcano, on the other hand, is a movie where they save the day by planning and executing a precision demolition of a building in 20 minutes to use it as a dam to divert the flow of lava into the ocean. I'm not kidding. That's the solution they come up with. And you know what? While I'm at it, that isn't the only ridiculous decision the characters make in Volcano. Instead of trying to slow the flow of lava by blasting water at its leading edge, they build up a wall of concrete barriers and then wait for it to pool up before blasting water at it. A decision so baffling to me, I don't understand how it made it past the first draft of the script. But then again, I don't know what I was expecting, given that the main character is introduced by burning himself on a hot frying pan, then dropping it on the floor and instructing a dog to lick up the mess around the still very hot pan. The man was introduced doing something stupid, so his idiotic reaction to a real disaster should really come as no surprise. In terms of overall plot, Dante's Peak is a lot more straightforward. There's basically one group of characters to follow and get to care about, and we follow them throughout the entire film. But Volcano introduces us to five different groups of characters, all with different stories to follow in the first couple of minutes. On the one hand, this isn't a terrible idea. This is a disaster happening in a city with millions of people. And so showing us how this event affects different groups of people raises the stakes and has the potential for some compelling storytelling. The problem is that most of these threads aren't really explored properly and don't really have satisfying conclusions, so they just add to the clutter in an already incredibly busy movie. There's just too much going on to follow this many characters and stories, and a lot of them feel like more like caricatures than actual people. And the movie would be just as effective, if not more so, if it were streamlined down to two or three plot threads instead of the five that we actually get. I especially think the movie could have done without some of these plot lines, because all they're there to do is provide some ham-fisted social commentary.
Look at their faces. They all look the same.
A task it fails at so spectacularly that it would almost be hilarious if it weren't for the gross oversimplification of serious issues that real people have to face. Like, hey, look at this awful rich man who hates poor people. Classism sure is bad, but it's okay. His rich wife is a doctor and wants to help the poor. And also, we blew up his new skyscraper to save the day. Or, hey, look at this white police officer who hates black people. Racism sure is bad, but it's okay. Some of the white cops think he's being a jerk. And also, this black man he's been unfairly targeting and harassing the entire movie decides to stay and help him with the concrete divider. And now the cop knows that black people can be pretty okay sometimes. Racism is solved! And all it took was burning down a major American city. Actually, there might be something to that. But all of these plot lines aren't necessary, especially since one thing I think Volcano does really well is make the city feel alive by randomly cutting away to these interesting characters just living their lives in the city, like this guy here in the wheelchair just drumming away in the park, or how it makes us care about the subway conductor with no dialogue just by showing him reading a book about screenwriting and waiting for his shift to start. There's none of the cliched dialogue we usually get trying to make us care about somebody, like being new to the job or having a kid on the way or almost retiring or whatever.
I'm not even supposed to be here today!
Oh, fuck you!
Just, this guy wants to be a screenwriter but drives a subway instead, which makes him way more relatable. It makes us care about the city in a way that is really unusual for this type of film, and it does it so well that these extra stories aren't necessary and just gum up the works. Another edge that Dante's Peak has over Volcano is the visuals. Dante's Peak is no Terrence Malick film, but there are some shots that are beautiful, and like, as a whole, it's competently shot, which is more than you can say for most of Volcano. Volcano looks like it was made for TV. Everything about it looks cheap, from the composition of the shots to the special effects. The thing is, though, it wasn't cheap. Volcano cost $90 million. It had a higher budget than Jurassic Park and its sequel and Independence Day and the fucking Matrix, to name just a few, and it looked like this. Majority of the budget obviously went to special effects. There are a lot of very complicated effects shots in this movie, and I even built a full-size replica of Wilshire Boulevard so they could destroy it. The problem is, I think that what they were trying to achieve was too ambitious for what was possible at the time, because, like, look at some of this shit. This is some of the worst digital compositing I've ever seen. The special effects shots in Dante's Peak, though, are astounding, even by today's standards. There's maybe one effects shot in Dante's Peak that doesn't hold up today, and there's one in Volcano that does. I've done better compositing than this, and I learned learned how to do it in YouTube. To be fair to Volcano, one of the reasons that the special effects look so bad is because there's simply more of them. It had a smaller budget than Dante's Peak, which is another factor, but it also tried to do far more with its money than Dante's Peak did. The action in Volcano starts much sooner than it does in Dante's Peak, really kicking into gear at about a half an hour in, where shit doesn't start getting crazy in Dante's Peak until slightly past the halfway mark. In Volcano, more than half the movie is set on a section of busy city street where everything is on fire. Things are constantly exploding throughout the entire second act, plus there are more extras, vehicles, and all that, because it takes place in a major city. Not to mention the entire section of a street that they replicated just to burn down, or the building they demolished to use as a dam. So, not only did Dante's Peak have an extra $26 million to play around with, their budget wasn't spread nearly as thin. Instead of front-loading all of the action after the first act, it's more of a slow burn, focusing on characters and their relationships and the science and building suspense, and then, finally, in the second half of the movie, they dump all of their money into a couple of set pieces, a strategy that, in my opinion, makes those set pieces far more effective. Not only do they look better because they are able to put more time and money into each one, but having fewer action sequences means that each one has more impact. There's so much happening in Volcano that it almost becomes white noise. Not only do the action sequences in Volcano look worse, they're also a lot dumber. There's a scene where Tommy Lee Jones and Anne Heche are surrounded by fire and lava and have to be lifted out by a ladder on a fire truck, being slowly swung out over the lava, and it's so hokey it's comical. Compare that to a scene in Dante's Peak where they escape being burned alive by lava flow by taking a boat out onto a lake, only to discover that the volcano has turned the lake into acid and their boat is melting. A, that's a real thing that can happen. B, it didn't require a convoluted setup like the stupid ladder thing, and C, the scene is hopeless and terrifying and is only made much, much worse when this happens. Fair, Volcano also has a scene where a character in a hopeless situation sacrifices himself to save someone, but the way it's shot and edited is so melodramatic that it loses a lot of its impact. The special effects in that scene are so bad that I laughed at it the first time I saw it, and again, the setup is so stupid that it's unbelievable. The entire thing was completely avoidable in so many ways. The people in this subway had almost a half an hour, and you're telling me that a train full of grown adults couldn't figure out a way to escape in that time? That they would have just sat there until they all passed out from the heat? Especially when all it took to get in from the outside was banging on the door with a pry bar? Bullshit. It is so dumb. Also, this wouldn't happen. Dude's standing on maybe 5 inches of lava, so he sure shit isn't sinking into it, so like, what, is he melting? Bodies don't do that. Volcano is full of these dumb set pieces that require these completely unlikely setups to make this slow-moving lava an actual threat, whereas Dante's Peak relies entirely on actual phenomena. It also helps that lava isn't the only source of danger in the film, because that shit gets real old real quick. And instead, the characters have to contend with ash, acid lakes, earthquakes, floods, and the absolutely incredible pyroclastic cloud sequence when the volcano finally explodes. I fucking love Dante's Peak, man. The casting in both films is pretty solid, though Volcano has a much larger cast with more recognizable actors. In Dante's Peak, Pierce Brosnan takes a break from his role as James Bond and stars alongside Linda Hamilton, with Grant Heslov and the thing's Charles Hallahan in supporting roles. Brosnan, a natural leading man, does a surprisingly good job of portraying an everyman scientist, and Linda Hamilton absolutely sells being an exasperated, overworked single mother with too much on her plate, and their chemistry is wonderful. Tommy Lee Jones and Anne Heche star in Volcano and are supported by Don Cheadle, Keith David, Jacqueline Kim, John Corbett, and John Carroll Lynch. Everyone gives perfectly good performances here, but I'll be honest, I've got a soft spot for Tommy Lee Jones, and he is in full-on Sam Gerard mode here.
All right, gentlemen, what I want to do is move the bus up against the museum like so.
Like so?
Yes, like so, and then I want to shoot out the tires on the other side of the bus. I cannot turn it over unless the tires on one side are flat, all right?
No one stands around yelling at other people to do their jobs quite like Tommy Lee Jones, and I could watch him do it for days. As far as I'm concerned, he's the best thing about the entire movie. Volcano was scored by my boy, Alan Silvestri, but I gotta say, he brought his fucking B game to this one. This has gotta be the worst score he's ever done. It's bland and generic, and it sounds cheap as shit. This is the kind of score you get for a made-for-TV movie. Like, Alan Silvestri is responsible for some of the most iconic film scores this side of John Williams. Motherfucker did Back to the Future, Predator, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Forrest Gump, the fucking Avengers movies, for fuck's sake. But for this, he completely phoned it in. Dante's Peak, on the other hand, has a fucking fantastic score. The main theme was composed by James Newton Howard, with the rest of the score filled up by John Fritzl, and it fucking slaps. It is haunting and chilling and ominous, and simultaneously captures the beauty and wonder of nature along with the looming threat of destruction inherent to a volcano. It's fucking great. If I ever made a list of favorite film scores, this one would be on it for sure. All in all, Dante's Peak is a more realistic portrayal of what this kind of disaster would be like in real life. The stakes might be lower overall because it takes place in a small town with a very small population, but the threats the characters face seem greater because they're more immediate, but are also grounded in reality. The lava and volcano isn't an immediate threat on its own, and there are entire scenes where people are just standing around talking while the lava slowly lurches forward in the background. It's such a non-threat that the filmmakers had to construct these ridiculous scenarios in order to put people in real danger. In addition to that, the sense of danger in Volcano was completely ruined by how cheesy the special effects look. This shit didn't even look good relative to other films that year. And while the filmmakers deserve a certain amount of respect for what they tried to pull off, this film was very ambitious, and I will never fault someone for trying. They didn't succeed in the end. The vast majority of the special effects in Dante's Peak were practical, with some digital compositing, and the CGI is used so sparingly that while still kind of dated because it's a 23-year-old movie, it doesn't detract from the suspense in the way it does in Volcano. Dante's Peak had fewer characters and storylines to follow, which means that everything gets more development than anything in Volcano. The characters in Dante's Peak feel like real people, whereas everyone in Volcano was painted with such broad strokes that they may as well be cartoons.